So now we're going to introduce a very common experimental technique called a Western blot or an immunoblot. And scientists use this technique to measure levels of a protein found in cells. It's a very common technique. You see it in many scientific research articles. And it's important for you to understand how an immunoblot works and what an immunoblot detects and what the data looks like. So let's go through an immunoblot and what it does and how it works. So the first thing is that immunoblots detect proteins. So let's say we have cells growing in a dish, and those are four different dishes, and each of those green circles or blue circles is a cell. We are interested in some protein, and we're going to call it protein X. And what we'd really like to know is the amount of protein X in each cell relative to the other cells. This is usually a relative determination comparing different conditions that you have treated cells with. So the cells in dish A are some type of cells, and the cells in dish B are the same type of cells, but they have been treated differently. Maybe the cells in dish B have been given a drug, and the cells in dish A don't have the drug added to it. And you want to know, does the drug cause levels of protein X to increase or decrease or stay the same? So you'll typically see lots of different samples processed in a Western blot. And for example, you can add increasing concentrations of a drug. So B, C, and D would have increasing concentrations of a drug. Or maybe you'd add the same concentration of drugs to all the plates, but you would test the, you would collect your samples at different time points. So A is 0 hours exposed to the drug, B is 1 hour, C is 2 hours, D is 4 hours. So maybe you're interested over time, the change in protein X in the same concentration of treatment. So you'll see a variety of these different conditions in papers, but suffice it to say, we're comparing the levels of protein one condition versus another condition. So the first thing we need to know is that a scientist takes the cells and breaks open the cells, extracts all the proteins in those cells, and analyzes them by something called SDS-PAGE, or sodium dodecyl sulfate polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. This is a technique that hopefully you learned about in a biochemistry course. It allows you to measure the levels of protein found in cells. And so let's talk about how SDS-PAGE works briefly and what it allows you to do. So, for example, let's look at this orange protein. And that orange protein is one of the many proteins found in said cell. The cells are cracked open, the proteins are extracted from it, they're applied to the gel, and proteins migrate through the gel using an electrical current, and proteins migrate based on their molecular weight or their size through this gel. It's porous. Large proteins don't get sucked through the pores as much as the small proteins, so the large proteins tend to stay toward the top of the gel. Smaller proteins tend to migrate toward the bottom of the gel. So this orange protein that's present in the cell, it has a molecular weight of 150 kilodaltons, or 150,000 daltons. That's the measure of a protein's size. And so it would migrate toward the top of the gel. And you can see on the left there is a ladder or a marker indicating where proteins of 150 kilodaltons migrate in this gel. Let's say there's another protein in the gel, a yellow protein, and it has a molecular weight of about 27 kilodaltons. And applying that extract to the gel, that protein would migrate between the 25 kilodalton and the 37 kilodalton marker. So cells contain thousands of proteins of a variety of sizes, very large proteins, very small proteins. And so when one performs protein extraction and analyzes the proteins by SDS-PAGE, you get a range of proteins throughout the gel. But we're not interested in all those proteins. We're only interested in protein X. How do we analyze levels of just protein X? We require something that binds to only protein X and binds to it very strongly and like a magnet, and then we can use other methods to detect that thing that's binding to protein X. And that thing is an antibody, which is why we call these immunoblots. We're using antibodies to bind the protein that we're interested in studying, in this instance, protein X. So as a scientist, you either create these or you purchase them from companies that make antibodies. So if you're interested in studying protein X, you purchase an antibody that has an antibody binding site which binds protein X. And you can make these, it's very easy to make these in animals or just pay a company to make them for you. So that's and what you see there drawn is an anti-X antibody. It binds protein X. So if you take this antibody and you mix it with the proteins that are separated here via SDS page, that antibody is going to go and bind very strongly to wherever protein X is found. And the more protein X is there, the more antibody will bind. And we have methods to detect where antibodies bind on a gel or in a Western blot, and you would detect protein X in that blot. So in this instance, in this example, protein X is some protein that's about 70 kilodaltons in size. And there's a certain amount of it in the cells in sample A. Now, in sample B, you can see that there's another band, and that's a term that we use for these intense little areas on a gel. They're called bands. And they are directly proportional. The intensity of that band is directly proportional to the amount of protein that is present in those cells. So if you look at the band in from the proteins extracted from sample B, that band is slightly less intense than the band in sample A. Those are the things that are called bands. And you look at the amount of darkness, the amount of blackness. More black, more intense, more protein A, or protein X. Thinner band, less protein X. So you can say that in sample B, there is less protein X than there is in sample A. So the terminology, some of the terminology that we need to get used to using, bands, and we talk about the intensity of bands. Some bands are more intense and less intense, which refer to more protein or less protein, respectively. The other terminology we use to look at a Western blot is lanes. So we number these lanes 1, 2, 3, and 4, and lane 1 is analyzing sample A, lane 2 is analyzing sample 3, lane 3 and 4 analyze lane C and D, respectively. And you will use throughout the course, when we talk about data from papers, I'll ask you to compare lane 1 versus lane 4. Did the protein level change from treating it the way that they treated it in lane 1 versus the way they treated it in lane 4? And if you look at all these different bands and all these different lanes, you can see that the cells treated, for example, from cells in sample C, there's still a decent amount of protein X detected. Whereas if you look at sample D, there's a very thin band, and that thin band corresponds to less antibody binding to that spot because there's less protein X in sample D. And so comparing protein X through all four of these samples, sample A has the most protein X, sample D has the least protein X. And so when we look at papers, and papers show treating cells with drugs or other compounds, scientists are always interested, what happens to some protein I'm studying? Does that protein level go up? Does that protein level go down? Does that protein level stay the same? And so this is how one reads a Western blot. And we will see many examples of that in this course. So you've got to be comfortable with this notion of detecting proteins and using Western blots to detect the levels of proteins.